Yep, that's me. You're probably wondering how I ended up in this situation.
My name is Shasta Henry, and this is the story of how I became an inspiring woman in STEM. Now, it didn't start in primary school, the place where it took me a long time to learn to tell the time and the times tables. I did like art and I did like the athletics carnival, but what I loved was picking up seashells off of the beach or turning over rocks to see what was underneath. I loved poking my fingers into sea anemones, and I adored my pet spider in my bug catcher. It didn't start in high school either, where I wasn't passionate about anything because all I wanted to do was fit in. I was still good at English. I was still very bad at maths. And I wasn't particularly interested in science. When work experience day came around in year 10, I went off to the hospital thinking I might be a nurse one day, but never a doctor. In fact, not just a nurse, but a medic in the armed forces. I had been an Australian Army cadet since the age of 12. But by the age of 16 in year 11, I was having an excellent time in my new best subject, art. I didn't want to be a nurse anymore. I won the art prize that year, and I was going to be an artist. Right up until year 12, when suddenly I'm having a great time in my new best subject, outdoor education. I won the outdoor education prize this year at the cost of failing art. Now, art had been one of my pre-tertiary units, one of my university entrance subjects, and I was now a subject short of a university score. But that didn't wind up mattering either, because I was going to do a gap year. I was off to England to work at a school camp as an outdoor educator because I wanted to be an adventure tour guide when I grew up. Now, at this point, every teacher in the audience can tell that I have attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. It's a dopamine deficiency disorder, meaning that my brain doesn't experience baseline satisfaction the way that yours might. I am constantly seeking external stimulation, and so my attention looks like it bounces around from subject to subject as things lose their novelty value and lose their difficulty, which is engaging. And I will constantly forever crave this external stimulus for my sense of satisfaction. But I didn't know that at this point in our timeline, because the disability is significantly underdiagnosed in women. It's more often we present with slightly different symptoms to men, and men are generally the target group for any kind of medical diagnosis. So while I did have a wonderful time traveling, working as a whitewater raft guide, I lived in Sydney and Cairns and Canada. You know that this isn't how I became an inspiring woman in STEM. Not only is my mind liable to change, but all this time in the background, my original passion had been growing with intensity. So picture it. I am down on all fours. I'm waiting for a rafting trip to arrive, and I am on my knees on a beach of glacial sand in Canada because I'm trying to catch a tiger beetle. These are very fast predatory beetles, and they've got big chomping mandibles. And I'd never lived anywhere that gave me the opportunity to see them in real life before. Now, this is exactly what happened when I became fascinated by the architectural bodies of the mud-daubing wasps that lived near our rafting shed in Sydney and the hypnotizing, iridescent jewel bugs that we rafted past in Cairns. I was 23 and I realized I didn't want to be an adventure tour guide for the rest of my life anymore. I was ready to start university. So I did a zoology major in my pretty standard Bachelor of Science in my undergrad. I moved on to doing honours in the island biogeography of Tasmanian insects, of course. I even got the opportunity to do a really exciting internship at the Smithsonian Institution, the National Museum of Natural History. I got to name species. I even got a species named after me. And as I had more and more interesting things to talk about, I started talking to more and more people about them, sharing stories of entomology, doing community outreach and science communication, going out into Tasmanian schools. And you see what I've done here? I've actually turned science back into adventure tourism, both an adventure activity in collecting insects and interpretive tourism in talking to people about it. So this is the platform from which I took my next step when I started my PhD in alpine Tasmanian insects and specifically their response to fire, which is changing along with our climate. And this is also the point in the story where my undiagnosed attention deficit hyperactivity disorder nearly ruined everything. You see, approaching my final deadline, I needed laser focus, which I simply do not have. And I needed to be able to sit down and complete hundreds of fiddly little tasks, which I simply could not do. I got to a point where I couldn't leave my house for fear of facing my desk and the sense of impending doom that it had started to represent. Now, whilst getting my diagnosis is a separate 10-minute presentation all in and of itself, after I started medication, I was actually quite able to submit my PhD and somewhere in the mix become an inspiring woman in STEM. I had a platform, I had a story, and I had a community in urgent need of hearing it. And that community was my own. It's a startling statistic, but almost one in two Tasmanians of working age are functionally illiterate. And a statistic far closer to my own heart, functionally innumerate as well. And while waiting for so long to get my diagnosis, yes, nearly upended the entire apple cart, I was also left wondering, if I'd been told earlier on that I had a learning disability, how many times would I have heard over my life how very difficult university was going to be? I think I probably would have believed I couldn't be a doctor long before I'd ever considered that I wanted to enroll. And I now know for certain that there are thousands of other students in Tasmania who are vulnerable to believing that university is only for very smart people, for very focused people, and for people who know exactly what they want to be when they grow up. And I can confidently tell them that that is simply not true. And it was this narrative that inspired my application to be one of the fellows of the Science in the Pub Tasmania Inspiring Women in STEM. So I am going to do a two-phase school incursion. I'm going to start by meeting the classes that have been selected for me by the teachers that I'm collaborating with. And we're going to do some myth busting via Zoom. It's kind of a meet and greet. We're going to talk about what society says that scientists are. And the fact that I can honestly tell them that a lot of these beliefs are myths. I am obviously not good at maths and I'm still not. I didn't know I wanted to be a scientist until I became one. I didn't even come straight to university. And I had an undiagnosed learning disability most of this time. And I've still been very happy and come out as very successful. Yes, I've been very well supported, but so will they if they ever choose to come to university. Our second stage, I'm actually going to be revisiting these students in their classrooms. And we'll do a hands-on entomology workshop. It's the specialty that I have to share with them. I think that this does a lot of value adding. It's confirmation that I am a real live scientist, but also someone who cares about them. One of my favorite things to do in any of my outreach is to be able to show students that they probably know a whole lot of high-level scientific information about insects they might not even realize. And so I often get to tell students or show students that they're quite a bit smarter than they might have thought that they were. And we do this through a hands-on alternative learning workshop. It reinforces that curiosity and play and observation are all really valuable learning practices as we do my Build a Bug workshop. And I am taking this on the road. I've identified six destinations where I can visit at least two classes, an upper grade and a lower grade. After talking with some of my science communication colleagues, it's been pointed out to me that the pathway to university actually starts at around grade three. And so these six destinations are some of those remoter locations where resources which trickle out from the university get dispersed and may not reach as often as they do in our bigger cities. might also take the opportunity to turn this into a video set of tutorials through the Peter Underwood Centre. And then it's a digital resource that any group of students can access anytime they want. And this is what that workshop has looked like in the other times I've delivered it to other learners, places like Libraries Tasmania, Learning Online, and even the South Hobart Tip Shop we collaborated during National Science Week. So the students learn what is effectively taxonomy. We do it in an age-appropriate set of language, can either be an insect body parts shopping list. And then they reinforce that message by gathering their resources and building an anatomically accurate insect model. And the output of this workshop is just always so satisfying to me. For instance, we can see here that this is a beautiful blue butterfly. And not just because it looks like a butterfly, although your eyes are telling your brain something that is scientifically accurate. I told you you knew more about insects than you knew you did. But I can tell, and this young man knows, that it is a butterfly because it has got clubbed antenna, and because it has a long curling haustellum, a straw-shaped mouth part. This is what they learn in the activity, and this is the level of accuracy that comes out in insect after insect model. And I'm just so inspired by how much intelligence and intuition can be brought out in any group of students from just one session of talk and play. This is how much fun science communication can be. Not finished with the puns quite yet, but I was absolutely thrilled to be able to reach out and draw on the knowledge of some of my science communication colleagues. And they've, like I said, been helping me to develop this idea. I've been able to draw on their empathy for their students and also their passion for science outreach. Many women and men and non-binary friends share this space with me. So, this International Women's Day, I'm honoured to be able to highlight the fact that this is an outreach project which actually stems from many inspiring women. Thank you so much for your time. I look forward to answering your questions in the panel.